call the meeting to order. Today is August 10th, 2020. And we're going to start with a roll call. Welcome everybody. So glad to have everybody at this table today. Ms. Bell, you want to start?
Amanda Bell.
Doug Isley.
Paula Redstraw.
Bob Wyatt.
Nikki McKinney.
Kimberly McMichael.
Brent Huss.
All right.
Brent didn't go.
Yeah. And Mr. Herman's with us as well as Dr. Trappell and other staff sitting out in the working area. It's good to see everybody today. We'll go on to announcements. 2.1, the next work session is scheduled for Monday, August 24th, 2020 at 6 p.m. at the Central Administrative Office here in Eden. And the next board meeting is scheduled for Monday, September 14th, 2020 at 6 p.m. here at the Central Office in Eden. We're going to, at this time, stand for a moment of silence, and then we'll move into a Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. Bob, will you lead us in a Pledge of Allegiance after the moment of silence?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have a motion to approve the agenda?
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Just one thing. On the agenda, I think you said that we had put some of the items that were priority.
Prioritize the reports?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. I'll make a motion.
Okay, Mr. Isley made a motion. Do we have a second?
A second. I mean.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we'll move on to public comments and board comments. Ms. McMichael, will you read the public comments segment, please?
Sure. In accordance with School Board Policy 2310, we will now turn to the public comment section of our meeting. On behalf of the Board of Education, I would like to express our gratitude for your contributions to our discussions of issues facing our board and our schools. Public comments do not necessarily reflect the views of the board. Board members will not respond directly to individuals who address the board during this portion of the meeting, except to request clarification of points made by the presenter. Out of respect for the privacy of our students and staff, discussion of matters involving individual students or personnel will not be permitted. All speakers will be allowed 3 minutes for their comments, and we ask that you please conclude your comments when you hear the second beep. The board will allow up to 1 hour for public comment. In the event that all speakers cannot be heard during the 1 hour designated, the board will allow time following the conclusion of its business for the remaining comments. Thank you to each of you who signed up for public comment today.
Okay, Mr. Ron Price?
He is seated upstairs, I think.
He's going to speak from upstairs.
No, he wants to come down to the podium.
Yeah, we got to bring him down.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All Hey, Mr. Price?
No. There's somebody on here.
I'm sorry.
Sounded like him.
I'm like, how did he get down here so quick?
Is there any way to put the microphone on the podium so they don't, folks don't have to get so close to it?
It's not even on.
Oh, it's not?
Is the microphone in on?
Okay.
No.
But this one does a great job. Oh, that's the other one's gone.
Okay, so that picks it up. All right, am I ready to speak?
You are, yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, Madam Chairman, board members, Dr. Shotwell, administration. I'm here to talk about the prayer. I've spoken several times about this, and teachers and administrators and staff members have come up and thanked me for the prayer, especially for them and the work that they're doing, because they realize the need for God's intervention. And I think that's a factor with our board, with the administration, and the whole school system. We're under dire straits. There are difficulties going on. I mean, there's financial stress. There's shocking events with individuals that are suffering from being isolated from individuals. So we need to consider that in our prayers to God. Some thank me because they are believers and they know God's infinite power. We know that God is everywhere present. He knows everything about everything, and he has all power to make those changes, to administer his will throughout the universe, not just locally. So tonight, I want to pray for our school board. If you choose to join me, but if you don't, like I say, this is for believers and those who trust in God and know God exists and he is in all power. So our God and our Father, we come tonight humbly before you, knowing that you are the one true and living God. You have made all things, and you administer the universe. Your laws and your will prevail throughout all creation. And we thank you, Father, for your love and your mercy. And we come to you tonight to lift up our school system, our school board members, our teachers, our staff, our students, our parents and administration. We pray for our elected official and those first responders who respond to desperate situations. Because there are times when the law enforcement or fire department or EMS have to come out and administer these functions that they are responsible for. So we ask your blessing upon them. Give them guidance and direction. Give leadership to our schools, because we know we're suffering from financial distress. Our state budget is probably going to be about $4 billion short. So there's a definite need, and we have other needs. So, Father, we thank you and ask these blessings in the name of your only begotten Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Ms. Mabel Shields?
Yes.
Let me.
Yes.
And I'll read the same.
Her address is 817 Hart Street, Reidsville, North Carolina, 27320. Commenting on agenda item 6.2, since the pandemic, the EBT has not been extended, can there be food delivery in place for some families as mine that have need for food but extremely hard to pick up food 5 days a week? That's a short comment with powerful. And I did respond back to her and told her that for the children that we are still doing the summer feeding through the end of the month, and that school age will be, if it's not changed, they can still have their numbers from last year. They can do the school lunch application, and that we're opening up other feeder sites.
And Mr. Jim Fink?
He's out there.
This is still so strange.
It's not on.
It's not on?
No, it's right here, right?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Very good. Well, good evening. Thank you all for your time today. I'm Jim Fink. I'm at 405 Wedgwood Court in Eden. Just wanted to say just a few things this evening. First and foremost, I wanted to congratulate Ms. McKinney in our, what seemed like months and months ago since we've seen each other, but on the election, the primary part of it. Anyway, congratulations. I wanted to do that face-to-face, and I know we talked on through Facebook, but I appreciated the way you handled everything, and as well as your family. There was much to be said about how one person handles an election, much less a whole entire family, and I couldn't be more pleased to have lost to a family, but I've known a lot of your family through church, and my respect and admiration was pretty eased by that fact, so I thank you and congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
I would be remiss if I didn't tell you guys that my 10-year-old wanted me to say one thing on his behalf today. He would like to be in real school, because this virtual stuff, he's tired of seeing mom and dad. He's tired of getting picked on by his 13-year-old brother. He'd just soon be with friends his age. So if y'all keep that in mind when you're making other decisions that will put these kids back together, which I wholeheartedly support. So, third thing I wanted to talk about is the budget in regards to how we're handling some of this money that we're not spending. And I sent Ms. McKinney a list a few weeks back that she was graciously good about sending over to the folks here at Central Office, and in return, got a lot of answers back. So thank you again for a fast turnaround. Old boards, I never got that. So having that representation in Eden and getting some answers back to some questions was refreshing. Not to say that I haven't gotten answers from the current board, I have, but up until this board took over, it was very hard to get answers from anybody, with very few exceptions. So I just wanted to bring that out. I don't look at numbers online, but I know the last board meeting I was virtual with most everybody else, and I was very happy to see over 400 some folks online last time. The vast majority of those folks were speaking in favor of keeping the kids at home. There was a strangely amount of number of teachers online on that one, and very few parents. Was that part discouraging me? And the parents that were on there were pretty vocal about the fact that we wanted the kids back in school, real school. Notwithstanding what actually happened, I supported what you all did. I would have liked to have had the option of having the kids that wanted to go. And I say that to lead into this. With the gap that's more than likely going to happen between the kids who don't have the access to computers, Chromebooks, or if they do have that access, to having that support at home versus what they would get by being physically in person with that teacher. Speaking for just our schools in my area, the teachers have been very engaged. I've heard very few problems with that, so I'm happy to hear that that's happening. I hope you guys will monitor that and the school system monitors that as well, because I'm still hearing lots of stories out there about teachers that are not engaged, and that's certainly not going to help some of our struggling kids. So with that, I thank you for your time, and I appreciate everything you do for us.
Thank you all. Okay, so we'll move on into board comments, 5.2. Does anyone want to make any comments? Ms. Bell, see you on the first.
I'd like to just take this opportunity to welcome our teachers back virtually. And I would like to thank the principals for actually working so hard to plan their open houses. I had a chance to scan some of them today, and teachers have been principals have been very creative, and especially those new entries to elementary, the kindergarten group, the middle school group, sixth graders, and then of course the ninth graders, and they have scheduled them so that they can give these groups of children in particular some individual attention. I think it's a very important. I think it's very thoughtful on their part. I know it's very difficult. They did not take a course in pandemic and what you should do in face of a pandemic. So I think they're all doing a wonderful job. And also I want to thank Dr. Shaw for reaching out to diverse communities to answer questions that the community may have concerning some of the requirements and some of the things that were going on in schools. I think it helped the community a great deal. And I understand you also on television, so I thank you for that and talking to the community as well.
In the midst of confusion and not getting good answers from any of the media or any of the state and federal people, I'd like to thank all the employees, teachers, students, parents, for understanding that these are times that have no easy answers. While I realize that remote learning is not a good option, hopefully it will soon be, able to move to face to face. I've got seven grandbabies, six of them are in public schools. One is going to be entering second grade. And I stop and wonder how a teacher can teach second graders, men. They haven't had first grade. So I know we've got big problems ahead of us, and I'm going to do what I can to make sure that we make the right decision. But I'm not happy with remote learning, but at this point, I feel like it was the right decision. September the 18th, maybe we'll know more and be able to make a good decision. Thank you.
Well, I would just like to welcome everybody back to school. It's good to know that we have our principals and our teachers back in the building, and I know that they've worked really hard and they're prepared really hard for those students. And I just found myself today thinking about all of those kids who are going to be entering kindergarten and how scary that might be for those parents. And we've got great teachers in the school system, and they are so looking forward to meeting those babies, and they're really working hard to have a great day in the house. And so, you know, it's going to be hard, and it's not ideal for any of us. And then I was thinking about all those kids that are seniors that were looking forward to all of those events for their senior year. And so we want parents to know that we've appreciated the way they've reached out, and I've appreciated what they've said, and we've taken to heart all of their concerns. And there's no easy solution, and there's no right answer.
I just echo what Mr. White said. He almost took my word for verbatim, so just echo what he said. And also, folks, just keep in mind that the board has to make some hard decisions, and a lot of this is dictated to us from Raleigh, and we have to go along with what they send down to us. And sometimes the decisions are hard, but we hope that we make the decisions that it's going to be the best for everybody. There's not a one-size-fits-all fix, but we just hope that we can continue to try to work with what we have and do the best we can for the students in the upcoming year. And just thank all the staff, all the behind-the-scenes people, classified employees, hourly employees, everybody in this school system is an integral part in making the school system work, and I just want to thank everybody.
I'm
going to
welcome the staff back as well
with
teachers, I mean everybody, back, and just to say thank you for your hard work, because I know it's been a rough road for you, your staff, your principals, and your teachers, your teacher assistants, everybody who is going to be hitting that, y'all are going to be hitting the road on Monday, really putting this to work. And so I know a lot of prayers have gone up for you guys. I know Mr. Price spoke about prayer in his public comment, and I just want to say that I certainly believe there is a place for that prayer here at the this school system, and as a school board member, I appreciate it. I know our teachers do, and I know our students do. Anybody else? All right, we're going to move on to item 6, which is the consent agenda.
We have several items on the consent agenda. Board members have had time to read over and ask questions about those items. I do have a question about the 6.2. Dr. Shotwell, could you just elaborate a little bit more about your conversation with the individual regarding the food? I just want to make sure I understand.
Yes, ma'am.
Students are getting what they need.
Well,
why
you know,
it was under 6.2?
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay.
Either.
Okay.
I just I mean that's what I got on the on the email address for public comments. But I did respond back to her, because I know there are a lot of people out there that help families that may not have transportation. And that's the beauty of this summer feeding type, because all you have to do is say, I'm getting it for 3 18-year-olds, 3 16-year-olds, and 2 2-year-olds. Boom. But September 1st, if the waiver's not put in place September 1st, then it strictly goes to children that are enrolled in the public schools who are age 5 to 18, and they have to have a student ID number. And now, if they're going to a school that's CEP, then it won't matter, but they still have to have their student number. But if they're going to a school that's not, which is 2/3 of our schools, then they have to have their student number. Those that had free reduced lunch last year, one of the nice things, the state's always taken care of the reduced rate for breakfast, so they've gotten no cost breakfast. But for this year, the state of North Carolina has waived the 40 cents for the kids to have to pay for lunch. So that's taken care of, but they still have to go through the process of filling out an application unless they're direct certified. So hopefully that will help out here. It sounds like if they're asking about EBTs, that's probably something that they're familiar with and have access to. I know there was a question about that, about why folks got the EBT cards. That was from the federal to the state. Anybody who was on free reduced lunch or in a CEP school received one.
All right, well, so let's move on with consent. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda? Thank you for that explanation.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we approve the consent agenda.
Okay.
Second.
It's been a second. Were there any questions? Okay. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. We'll move on to item 7.1. We're going into reports.
If you'll switch back to campus.
Thank you.
Thank you. There you go.
Since we talked about that 1 hour, I'm going to pay attention to that.
Okay. Oh, yeah, no, that's fine.
Okay.
Good evening, Madam Chair, board members, and Dr. Shotwell. We appreciate the opportunity tonight to talk to you about our remote learning. And I have a team that are going to help present with us. I want them to come in and introduce, we have Ms. Elizabeth Covell. She's our Director of Digital Learning, Professional Development, and Media. We have Christy Bailey, who's the principal of Dillard Academy. We have Dr. Tina Whitten, who is the instructional coach at Dillard Academy. We have Ms. Kristen Knight, who is a kindergarten teacher at Dillard Academy. We have Ms. Jordan Vickers, who's a fourth grade teacher at Dillard Academy. We have our new digital learning lead teacher, Ms. Sherry Barnett, who is presently the instructional coach at McMichael High School. And then you have me. But they have done a wonderful job. We went over to Dillard Friday and talked about the presentation for over 2 hours, and I think you guys are going to be amazed at some of the things that our teachers have planned. So looking forward to letting them share a little bit with you. I want to start, and Dr. Whitten and Ms. Baylor are going to help me a little bit with this, but this, what you see before you, are district-wide guidance from the Curriculum and Instruction Department concerning our remote learning expectations. And we certainly know that our parents and our students and our board members and community expect that remote learning look a lot different than it did in the spring. We know we were in emergency mode in the spring, but we've had a lot of time since then to plan and prepare. So what we really want from a district perspective is, is a more normal, schedulized approach to the schooling day. And you'll see that in some of the schedules and some of the things we shared with you today. We also know that we have to record daily attendance this year. We've got some new guidance from the Department of Public Instruction about that attendance, and I'll go over that in just a few minutes. And we also want our lessons to be very organized and look very similar to all of our students each day. So we want our teachers to begin with a five-minute or less pre-recorded message about the daily learning objectives that the students will be facing each day, a review of the essential question and the learning targets for that day, and then just going over the assignments that are going to be assigned for that day as well. We've asked teachers to record all their Zooms that involve direct instruction. And then we are reminding everyone that we will be resuming normal grading practices this year. So we are going back to those normal grading practices. That's very important for our parents and students to understand. And then again, the guidance document is listed below. I'll just click on it and show you this document here. And the basic, as it's loading, the basic premise behind this is in the past, when we've been under normal situations, you don't enroll a student until they physically show up in your classroom. The difference this year, you enroll the student the first time you talk to that student. So on the first day of class next week, if you have a class-wide Zoom and you can see every student, then you officially enroll that student, and that student is now part of our ADM. So after that initial enrollment, we do have present off-site options. So if students are working remotely and they are doing assignments and or checking in with the teachers daily through like a Google form, that does count for present, and there's a new code in PowerSchool that says present off-site learning. So that's something that's new again this year. So we will know quicker what our actual enrollment numbers are looking at than maybe we originally thought. So that's something that's positive too. Don't know if that's cooperating, so I'm going to go back to this. Did it just spin?
It just would spin. I could never get it open.
And there's something wrong with that one. I'll look at that. So let's go back to the guidance, because I want Dr. Whitten and Ms. Bailey to talk a little bit about the expectations for elementary.
So I think the biggest piece is the consistency. That's the big change, is that this is consistent. Teachers have a little flexibility. They're all doing what they need to do to meet their student needs with their grade levels within their rooms. But just that consistency of we do, I mean, we'll get to share with you in a moment, we do these must-do, can-do. So it's very clearly laid out what the student is expected to do every day and what extra opportunities they have. And I think that once parents and students see and understand where to access that information, it has, like, the worry and the apprehension is really just melted away, because they understand this is what I need to do and this is how I contact my teacher when I have a question. Those are like the biggest pieces. So the big key word I say is consistency.
Dr. Whitten, anything to add?
Well, I think it's going to be more clear actually for you guys to see. These are just some general guidelines that we came up with, but I think it'll be more clear once you see what the teachers are doing. You can see the consistent daily schedule. You can see what they're doing as far as Screencastify, Seesaw, Google Classroom. I think these expectations will become more clear. One thing I do want to say is that we are beginning our fourth week at Dillard Academy, and we have found that communication is huge. And so we are really asking that our teachers use a consistent classroom platform for communication. And at Dillard, we're using Dojo. There are several things that can be used, but we're finding that communication with parents is huge. They are constantly using the office hours from our teachers. They're looking forward to the agendas every day. So we've just found that that's a big, big piece for us.
And at the secondary level, again, much like we've talked about already, much more scheduled students will know that they will follow the normal block schedules and daily schedules as far as when teachers will be online and available. We also know that students still need the flexibility to be able to work in the evenings when maybe parents are home to help and assist. So that still will be there, but there will be more structured and scheduled times for teachers to have interaction with students each day. So I think that's very important for us to understand. All right. So we will give you an overview a little bit later of our platforms, learning platforms that we're using, Seesaw, Google Classroom, and Canvas. I'll move ahead. So we wanted to really let you look at what it looks like in person. And Dillard's always our frontier pioneers, and they're leading the way. And they've done a great job of showing us what they have done. So I'm going to ask Ms. Knight to come up.
How are you?
What's my pressure? You see the pressure anywhere? It's weird.
It ate it.
It escaped.
There it is.
There it is. So I'm going to start by just talking briefly about what we did for kindergarten open house. Kindergarten open house is usually a big deal. Parents are excited. Kids are excited. It's their first time at school. So this was a little bit more challenging. But we decided that we would have parents and children come and meet us in person. We did this outdoors, and we did do social distancing. But we felt that it was important that they did get to see who their teacher and their teacher assistant was going to be. We also wanted to provide them with how to use the Chromebook face-to-face. For a lot of these parents, this was brand new. So once they met their teacher assistant, they were escorted back to us. We had parents sign up for a 30-minute time slot with us ahead of time, so we knew who was coming and when. So we had their Chromebooks ready to go. We had previously bookmarked Seesaw, which is what K2 was using as our learning platform, and we bookmarked our classroom websites, which in kindergarten was a really big piece of how we're delivering our instruction, and we wanted every child to be able to get there as soon as they logged into their computer. So when the parents came back to us, we checked out the Chromebook to them, we sat down with them, and we showed them, this is how you log into the computer. This is where you're going to find Seesaw. This is where you are going to find my classroom website, and this is where all your assignments are going to be. We also provided them with this frame bag that we made for all of our kindergartners, and you can see in the pictures up here, we included math manipulatives that we wanted them to be able to use at home that they just may not have there. A big piece of the younger grades is hands-on learning, and we can't do everything through the computer. So even though they may see me through the computer, I can say, go get out your cubes today. We're going to use these in our math lesson. So we felt like that was important. We also personalized each bag with name handwriting sheets for each individual child. A lot of children in kindergarten come to school not able to write their name, so we thought that was really important that they would have these tools with them at home. First week's homework also went home, and we shared with parents all the back-to-school information in a folder that all went home.
All of that information was shared, and that's great. I'm going to jump ahead for a second. I really wanted Ms. Knight to show you some examples of the lesson, and I think this was really, I was super impressed with this work.
We also told our parents that we were doing a hybrid approach in kindergarten. There are things that I cannot teach through a computer, like cutting and gluing and crafts, which are all a really big part of being five and going to school. So we do ask that our parents pick up a paper packet on Mondays, and they are using that in collaboration with our online digital resources.
A bunch of these links were working.
Yes,
So this is my classroom website. This is bookmark on all of their Chromebooks. So when they go here, this is my class's home base. So I use, for example, with our daily schedule, we talked about consistency. My parents know that if they go here, and a paper of this also goes home. So this is just our general expectations that went home with them at open house that explains this is what you're going to have to do on paper, this is what we're going to offer online. And each week I upload their weekly assignments. So they have this in their paper packet, but for those of us that get on the computer, they can go here and find all their assignments listed. And these links are actually clickable, so if they are on the classroom website and they're like, oh, my child needs to watch the morning message, they can click here, and it's going to take them to the morning message page of the website. So what we've been doing is uploading our recordings, and in this morning message, we do include what their goals for the day are. So our daily learning expectations, what they need to finish. Anything that we sent home that was paper, we go through the activity with them because they are visual learners. They have to see it. So I will model the activity for them, and then if they need to go back and see it, it's here for them to find.
It's like click on that first one and just let everyone see a little preview of what it looks like.
Good morning, Kinder Clouds. Today is Monday. I hope that you had a great weekend. You got some rest, and you are ready to complete your schoolwork this week. We're going to start out today the way we always do, by talking about our daily goals, okay? First goal, you are already doing. You are watching me giving you this morning message, and we'll do our shared reading activity. When you are finished with this video, I'm going to have you work on your morning work. And we have a Chicka Chicka Boom Boom color word practice page for you to...
Okay. So that's just an example. That was this morning's morning message. They are typically about 25 minutes long, but we go through a whole bunch of shared reading activities. We always share a story. You know, we try to add some song and some movement into. So they cover a lot of standards in that amount of time. We also do foundations, math. All these videos are linked down here also. And just to make it easier for families, we have made a computer lab on our website. So these parents can go to this computer lab, and then they can click to get to any website that they need to get to. So if I ask them to get on iReady to do their diagnostic, they're just going to find that icon, and it's going to take them to the login page. So we try to make it as easy as possible for these parents to access them.
How many kids did you log in on that first day?
I have 17 in my class. The ones that did not come that day, it was very few. They typically have siblings, and we did a separate from book rollout day for the rest of the school in kindergarten, and most of them came the day before. So I just logged them in while they came over. So we did help everybody.
But you get counted for that many children. All of your students have been counted.
Yes, so all of our children have been accounted for. I only had one child that did not take a school Chromebook, and that was because her mother had purchased a Chromebook to use for school purposes, but we walked them through the login process.
That's great.
And Ms. Mike, you modeled a foundations lesson for us Friday, and even in her background on the computer screen, she's got the foundations posters there. It looks just like a real classroom. And, so the videos are linked there as well, so she's done an excellent job.
The Bitmoji classrooms are fun. Once you make more, you want to keep going.
Yeah,
not Seesaw yet?
You can go
ahead and do it. Okay, so kindergarten is using Seesaw this year, and we just kind of wanted to show you what a Seesaw assignment would look like. We're using Seesaw in kindergarten for foundations and for math lessons. So we're using it for those two purposes, and we do about 4 a week. This was the classroom that he was talking about with all the foundations letters in the background. This is the one they really like.
Good morning, kindergarten. I am here with your very first foundations lesson. So to get started today, I'm going to talk about what foundations is. Foundations is the program that we will use to help you do a few things. First thing Foundation is going to help you do is learn all the letters of the alphabet. It's also going to help us learn the sounds that those letters make. Lastly, it's going to help us learn how to write all of the letters correctly on writing lines. So today, we're going to get started by me introducing you to a friend of mine. Can y'all say hello? This bird is a special kind of bird. They are very, very smart birds, and they can see really well. I wonder if you know what kind of bird this is. I'm going to let you think about it for a minute. All right, so this bird is an owl. So if you guess owl, you are right. Now this bird has a special name. His name is Echo. And Echo is here to help you learn your letters and your letter sounds.
Now, the way Echo wants you to do that is to be able to echo what I say. So today, we're going to practice not with letters, but just with a simple word. We're going to practice with the word hello. So first, I'm going to say the word hello. When you see Echo fly up onto the screen, it'll be your turn to say hello back to me. You ready? We're going to give it a try. Hello. Your turn. Good. I hope you said hello. We're going to try it one more time. Hello.
Hello.
Did you say hello? Awesome. All right. So,
So in Seesaw, the way it works is like a running journal. So instead of posting all the assignments in Seesaw because they were discontinuously moved down, we post the assignments we're going to give them each day. And then I get a journal feed. So when my kids go ahead and submit their assignment, I'm able to click it, approve it. The feedback I can give, I can either type it in, or a really cool feature is that I can actually record myself giving them feedback so then they can hear it themselves. So we were just going to briefly show you the response to that video that you just watched. At the end of it, we go over our foundation's writing lines, and their assignment was to record themselves saying the name of each line. So this is a little boy responding to that assignment.
Stone, climbing on, grass gun, run along.
But so that was what they, you know, the goal for that day was just to learn the name of those four lines. So that was the end of the activity, and that's what they had to turn it to me. So I like that it's live, and I can give them feedback very quickly. So as soon as it comes in, I actually get an alert on the cell phone. It comes right to me, so I can go ahead and respond right there in the app. So the feedback is very quick.
So I thought I was watching a PBS education show with somebody when I visited her classroom. But she's done a great job and is a great model for all of our other teachers to see how to make this work. So thank you. All right. And the favorite's going to come up.
In saying that, are our teachers in the same grades throughout the county? Is there something set up where they can talk to each other and say, look, this concept is, I'm having a hard time getting my brain around this concept. Tell me what you're doing, or help me with that. Do we have something set up for our teachers?
Yes, we started professional development this summer. So all of our teachers have been trained in this model. So they've been talking about this throughout. And we will continue with our CASA. And collaboration around student achievement, that's going to be very important for us as we move forward as well.
And just to add on, in addition to that, Seesaw allows teachers to collaborate along with all of our other resources. So you can actually add extra teachers in there, and you can share lessons across the district.
Nice. And Ms. Vickers, I want to kind of summarize some of this.
Yeah.
You jump in where you want. This is the presentation that she shared with her parents at Open House, and I thought it was just a great example of welcoming the students. She gave a little bit of background about herself and her family, things that she likes. She also had a special welcome to each student. She put in their names, so I thought that was awesome. And then she just went through the supply list and just daily expectations once school starts. She also included the things that we have to do in a normal year anyway, like making it known that we're a Title I school and that there are Title I compacts. So all of that was in here as well. And I thought it was just a phenomenal way of introducing her and her classroom to the students. Even gave them pictures of what the class will look like when they come. So, Ms. Figures, anything you want to say?
Yeah, with Open House is such a, like, it's really important. Like Kristen said earlier, when we do Open House, I was, like, kind of sad to miss that time. That's my connection piece. That's how I start that relationship with not just my students, but my parents, which is huge. And so, I talked to my parents about, I shared it on Dojo. And I also shared it on Google Classroom for my kids. So if parents couldn't connect to Dojo, they could get on their kids' Chromebooks once they picked up, and then we could watch this. Because I had it live for 2 weeks and lots of time. And part of it was I had a parent survey for them to tell me about their child. And then I had a survey for them also to fill out if they wanted to Zoom with me. Which I was like, you know, I can't physically be with you, but I can be face to face with you through the computer. And I had a lot of parents that took up on that. Well, what was cool is the kids obviously popped in and I got to meet the entire family because a lot of times younger siblings, older siblings, hey, you know, we're all getting to know each other. And the best part of that was that that started that connection piece, that started that relationship with not only my students but my families. And so that's why I really, it was really awesome. It worked out amazing. And he just had my example schedule, which is just kind of like an overview because I wanted parents to know what was coming up but not feel like they're tied to times, because it's kind of like my times are office hours. I have office hours 2 times a day, and I give students a time to jump on with me as face-to-face as we can be, and I have kids that that's their schedule. They're on at 9, and they're on at 3:30 every day, and they wave, and we talk, and I'm not going to lie, sometimes again, it's not about school. It's they're telling me what they've been doing all day and how much fun they had over the weekend, but that is that relationship piece, and Zoom has like truly been amazing. Because if I need them outside of office hours, they can say, Ms. Vickers, I need to Zoom. So we jump on a Zoom together, and we're right there, which has just been amazing. It really has been.
You want to talk about yours?
Yeah, this is an example of like my lesson plan. So this is me for the teacher, what I have. So what I do is I kind of keep my Google Classroom link here so that I have it. I have my student slides that I'll show y'all in a second. And so this is for me. This is not what I would send to my students. This is to keep my brain in check. And it's actually from Dr. Witten. She's the one that set it up for us and then gave it to us, and it's been amazing. Because I love organization, so that just really helps me out. And so it helps us to know our standards. We have what we're going to do, and then I put my links straight in there, so I'm not looking for them. They're right there. Because my links are going to be right there for the kids as well. And so we just kind of go through day one, day two, day three, day four. And then I also wanted to mention, at our school we were doing Flex Friday, but we recently changed it to Flex Wednesday. And with Flex Wednesday, we're doing that so that when we get to the AB days, and whenever that is in our future, we'll be getting there, we will be doing Flex Wednesday at that time instead of Flex Friday. Now what that is our enhancement teachers put together a choice board for our students to do something that's the fun, which I'll show you. I'll pull it up so you can see it. But it's really cool because my kids love to tell me what they've done on their flex day. And then what's also really awesome is that my students who need a little extra time, or they need that extra time with me, I'm like wide open that day. And I don't set office hours that day. It's like, you message me, we'll be on office hours. And like last Wednesday was the first time we've done it as a Wednesday. And it was amazing because I had Monday and Tuesday with them, and then I sent out my message and I'm like, hey, we missed the last 2 slides yesterday. You want to Zoom? And so we Zoomed for a little while, got those slides done, and they're already caught right back up. So it's a perfect day for the kids if they need it to be with me, which is awesome. And so, and then you can see how our enhancement teachers have done an amazing job with this, setting it up for us. And this requires no explanation. Spend time doing a fun activity, because we have to remember, these are still children. And so most of them love to tell me, one of my kids last year when we did it, his was always fishing. And he had to tell me what he caught and what he had used his bait. So it was always awesome. I loved it. But that's pretty much, this is my lesson plan. Let me go to court mom, or the students.
Can I ask a question? Do all of the enhancement teachers teach their classes on that particular day?
So what they'll do is they have things that pertain to their class.
Right.
So they're not always going to do something for art, but the student is available for them.
I think she was also asking, do they get specials on other days too?
Right now it's on that flex day.
We have our enhancement teachers also added to Google Classroom and Seesaw, so that when we break out into small groups, we can do breakout sessions in Zoom. And we have to have an adult in all those breakout sessions. So if Jordan is teaching a guided reading class, they'll be in the same Zoom meeting. Jordan will be in a breakout session. One of the enhancement teachers will be in the breakout session. We might have a teacher assistant so that we're putting all those differentiation pieces in there.
And so this is an example of how I set up my virtual classroom. So this is where my students go. This is their daily, where they go to see me. And so, like, here's my week. I did a weekly message. And since then, this was, like, the first time I really kind of got into it. I still do my weekly message, but on top of that, I do a daily message, too, because they need it both times. And so it's just kind of me going through. And Miss Bailey talked about the must-do can-dos. This is how we lay it out. So there's their must-dos for reading, math, and science. and then here's our can-dos. And what we do is we do science for a couple of weeks, and then we do social studies for a couple of weeks, so we flip back and forth. And so, like, when they click here, it'll take them straight down to me talking to them for that week, and that kind of thing there. Do you want me to share my Google Classroom with them?
You can, yeah.
Okay.
So the thing I love about that is she has all the links and there's a daily message. Even you can click on her little emoji and she, a video pops up as well. So all of that's there for the students. It's very user-friendly and it looks engaging as well. So I think
men love it. I have one child and he's on there at 7:30. He's already wide open going through all my links. He's awesome. But so this is my Google Classroom. We have the stream. I use the stream for announcements. So like this is my weekly announcement and I split it up into what one group of my kids needed and what another group of my kids needed for announcements to catch them up. But the place that I spend the most time is in my classwork. So I have attendance section that stays at the top so they can always find that attendance link. And then I come down and this is all of my kids. They have checklists for completed work. And then we come down and so this is this week. And what I always want them to do is start in that Google slideshow because that's my instructions of what they need to do. So if I click here, I can show you the one for this week. And so now you see where I've added, watch this video first in bold and highlighted. So they click there and it takes them to my video. And I use Screencastify. Screencastify is awesome because I can just show them exactly my screen. Like if I have a kid ask me a specific question, I can send them a Screencastify video that shows them their exact answer of me doing it. It's not just me saying, click here, they can watch me, which is amazing. And so I do that each day with their video. And once again, I have my weekly video, which takes them down here to it. And then, like, this week we were doing the Achieve Level set, which is included in there. And we just kind of, all of their links are in there. And if it says that it's not in there, I tell them, go back to Google Classroom. So if they went back to Google Classroom, I have each of the days broken down. So it's Monday must-dos, and they can click on it there. And Tuesdays, and then Thursday, Friday, can-do, and then office hours. So I keep all of my office hours recorded. And like this is the one from today. So all of them are in there. So any child at any time can watch them.
One of the things I wanted to add, although Billard is very structured in their schedule that they have, what they found also that there's really a need for parents to contact the teachers in the evenings as well, because they just, little kids just need that help. So they set up office hours two times a week for a couple hours each session to kind of provide support in the evening for parents as well. But really the instruction during the day, the level of planning that they've done during the remote is very easy to follow. And you even mentioned that the students are really keeping up with their work. And
yeah, mine are really good. I do a lot of like messaging with my students and then back it up straight with a message to the parent. And like those completed work checklists, they're awesome because I have check boxes so they can use it to click their check boxes when they're done. And then I turn them green when they have it done, so it's been awesome.
Have you seen any issues with the folks that don't have the internet and they have to go on and see the recordings later?
Actually, what I do for that, because I have three on paper packet and one that's on paper packet, it's due to internet issues. And I understand that because I personally do not have internet at my house, so I understand. So what I do is she has Dojo, so I will take my link of my recordings, like I did it today, I say, good morning, here is the recording for today, and here's your recording for tomorrow, so you go ahead and have them when you have time. Make sure you watch this before you start your math. So she has, when she pulls up her phone, there's a direct link. She clicks it, pops straight up on her phone, and she shows her child what my recorded video was for math, like my math lesson today.
Good.
So do you all have any other questions about Seesaw or Google Classroom?
Have you had any questions from parents?
Yes. I will show you something that Ms. Covell has put together. Mm-hmm. It's a great resource for parents, especially dealing with all these online platforms. We'll show you that in just a second. Ms. Barnett's going to show us Canvas and what that's looking like. We don't have a secondary school in place yet, but she will show us some of the training that they have.
Can I ask a quick question? Sure. I think Ms. Bell asked about the enrichment classes. So just to follow up, I think I just didn't understand. Do the children get an assignment from all of the enrichments? Like, are they? What about like going to the library? Are there links available online for kids to have books? What about like music?
Yes, every enhancement teacher is a part of the instruction. They're all doing that. Now the schools are doing it a little different. And I'll show you an example of that. Some schools are doing it during that flex Wednesday. Others are building it into the day as well. I know a lot of our secondary schools, like middle schools, they're planning their enhancements in the second half of the day. But also, while most of the kids are doing enhancements, kids that need additional work and pull out, they are being pulled out by their core teachers during that time as well to get them caught back up. So every school is doing a little different, but they are getting that support from those enhancement teachers. I think I'm here to shut down. So you want to sign in?
Sure. Okay.
You might have to actually.
Yeah, I'll go on it. That's okay.
This is just second.
I'm going to talk about 6 through 12.
And while Sherry's doing that, I will say that we have a student documentation sheet where we keep up with students who are not participating. And Ms. Bailey and I looked at that today, and we are excited to see that we have 94% of our students that are participating, either in paper packet or online. And we have a system in place to get in touch with those parents who are not participating. So 94%, I think, is pretty good.
I think the kids want to be in school so badly until they want to interact with their teachers.
So I'm going to discuss Canvas with you and just some things that it might look like. This summer, we spent a lot of time doing professional development with all of our teachers. So we did an elementary and a secondary level. We had over 600 teachers participate in it, and it ran for over a month. And we had some amazing results and feedback from that, so we were very excited. During that, what we did for secondary is we talked through Canvas, but not just Canvas, best practices of teaching remotely. So there's a lot to transition for teachers, and we wanted to make sure that we covered not only the use of the program, but also how to use it in the best manner for your content. We also know for parents and students at the secondary level, they're navigating not just one teacher's classroom, but four. So we wanted to come up with a more consistent way for Canvas to look so that they're not trying to transition between this teacher is doing it this way and this one is using something completely different. And so we tried to set up just two basic options for setup because we don't want teachers to be completely pigeonholed out of creativity because they make some amazing things. So the first example I have is just, it looks like an activity stream at the top. We recommend to all teachers that they put their announcements at the top of their page so it's the first thing that students see. So they can use this announcement feature. If a parent has paired themselves in Canvas with the student, they see announcements, they see grade messages, and they see updates. So we are recommending the parents, we're going to try and get as many as possible to pair with their students so that they can see all those updates coming from teachers. The first option we laid out was just literally putting in a header for the day, and then under that you would see the activities. So they have a daily agenda video, followed by a choice board assignment, and then it says, let's work an iReady for 15 minutes. So students and parents would be able to see this, and you would see all the expectations for the day. The next option was just making what we call a page per day. So what you would see is the week, and then each day would have a page laid out for students. And on Monday, they would go in and click on this page. And I just made a example for y'all to look at. I have a wonderful teacher at McMichael that made herself a Bitmoji classroom as well. So she put together this classroom, and you can see she's got the agenda and her learning target for students to see what they're going to be asked to do with a timeline. We noticed last year that secondary students kind of struggled with how much time to spend, and so we wanted to lay that out for them. Just spend 20 minutes on this. And then what she did, it's not loading, but she created a welcome video for that day where she goes over her agenda and her Canvas page and says, I need you to click this, this, this. After that is a set of recorded notes. It's actually a video that I made when I was in the classroom of me teaching how to factor. And so it's a video that we've been using for years because we've had it recorded. and that would be their instruction, and then it would link to their assignment and their Zoom for the day for follow-up and feedback. So we spent a lot of time with teachers talking about best practices, and Canvas has a lot of wonderful features. We talked about how feedback is the most important thing from teachers, and it has comments you can type. It also has audio and video feedback so teachers can record themselves. And then, of course, we recommended, again, like Jordan spoke about, using Screencastify as much as possible to record what you're being asked. And I've noticed that that's what helps a lot of people when they can actually see it. And I was a math teacher. So with math particularly, when a student sends you an email response is not usually what they need. So we highly recommend Screencastify, and we have touch screens so they can write right on their screen, the teacher, and send it to the student. And so that's kind of what we've put out there at secondary.
Thanks. Any questions about Canvas?
Can you zone the whole class in high school? Are they going to do that?
They are. So we are recommending some whole class Zooms, and it depends on which content or which subject, but we recommend whole class Zooms for that feedback piece and for the questions. So recording lectures, but usually when students need your support is when they're working on practice. And so we want open office hour Zooms for that time. And also during the school day, when we're following our regular schedule, they will have Zooms, say first period. And that example I set up, it would be at the end of class. And at the end of class, that way they can say, okay, you've done your lesson for today. What do you need support in? Go over some things they've noticed students are struggling with. And then also we recommend they use the polling feature in Zoom. It's really great. You can put in a question and answer choices, and students can respond. So you can quickly know how many students got this right, how many didn't. And at the end of the Zoom, you can pull a report, and it tells you exactly which student answered and which way. So that's quick assessment for them to look at and say, okay, I've got this many students not understanding, and I know which ones don't, so tomorrow I'm going to pull them for a small group Zoom.
I want to be mindful of time. So there are examples of schedules, and we can look at them, or you know, they're there for everyone to look at. But the main thing with schedules, we are back to a normal schedule where there is a time and a place for your math instruction, for your English instruction. And we really wanted to align this for an easier transition when we do come back to face-to-face learning. So unless there's questions, I'll just...
I have one quick question about the schedules. The elementary and the middle school look pretty simple. I noticed under the high school plan on the schedule, there were three options. Who chooses those options? Is it the teacher or is it the students?
Well, and that's a great question. I actually took those down to just one now, so if you refresh that. That was a part of some initial planning earlier in the summer when we were looking at all kinds of different options.
Okay.
The reason I left this plan here in, and this is something that we may actually face once we get back to face-to-face, based on the bus routing and how many routes that we have to have, we may have to have a little bit of an adjustment, and that's why I left this one in. If you look in this model, we have CCRG at the high school first period, and really even second, last period of the day as well. Because we want to protect the four core courses, and we know that the CCRG courses are online. So if we do have staggered buses, if we have three routes of busing that's coming in, you know, it's not going to interfere with the core academic content. So we wanted to put that one in there just to show you of what adjustments we may have to make once we do get back. So I'm glad you asked. That's the only ones up there.
That's the only one.
Yeah. Because the others I thought were too confusing because we're already in Plan C. So I just took those. But those were just a part of initial planning ideas that we had earlier this summer. Thank you for that question. All right. I do want to show you this. Ms. Covell, please come on. This remote learning parent resources website is really going to be a phenomenal tool for our parents. And I'll let Ms. Covell show you this.
So with the professional development, we wanted to make sure that we had consistency with what we told parents also. So I've spent some time developing this, and this basically allows a parent to go to one place and get some help and some assistance with being able to access our platforms and to learn more about them.
So there is a login launch pad here with the most commonly accessed programs that we have, including email, NCA Cloud, and our three platforms that we have at the high school level. And also in that, there are we're embedding video tutorials on how to navigate those. So if a parent, this is a first time, or a student doesn't remember how to log in to like NCA Cloud, this video takes them step by step how to do that with the video and an audio voiceover. In addition to that, we wanted to make sure that our kids were being able to get some help and support if they had technical Chromebook issues, so we have a link in there for Chromebook stuff. We also have ways to support your child with remote learning, of just kind of like how to set up the environment for your kid to be successful, how to communicate, when to communicate. And then finally, we wanted to also embed those North Carolina free resources, because NCDPI has a lot of stuff for like early literacy and EC students, and a lot of just resources in general for parents with remote learning. As you scroll down this page, you can access it several ways. You can access it up top right here, where it says extra support. You also can scroll down, and we have every different platform that we use at elementary, middle, and high, with the icon so that people can easily find it and click on it. In addition to that, we have a drop-down box up here where a parent can just drop down and find. So, for example, we were just talking about Canvas. You can go into this. It has direct links for students and parents. It has what it is, why we're using it. There's login help. It shows them step-by-step how to log in. It also, if you're having trouble, there's password help, who to call. And then there's family support. So these are support documents for families that allows them to go in and get connected with their kid on whatever device they're on. And then also there's some troubleshooting help in case they're running into trouble. And we've done this with every platform that we have.
So it all looks the same. So click on another one and show them. No matter which platform you're looking at, the directions and layout are exactly the same with the login help and all of that information.
Oh, that's great.
Yes.
And we've tried to keep it, I wanted to just keep it in a format that looked familiar. So it has a lot of the feel of not only our Rockingham County Schools website, but DPI's website.
I know that you work with that, actually.
I do assist that. Lisa Miller is actually our AIG lead.
Are we doing anything different with that group of kids? Sometimes we sort of overlook them.
I know that each
not intentionally, but sometimes we do. So are we offering any additional resources or enrichment for our AIG kids?
So we actually have one of our AIG teachers here.
Mm-hmm. So part of my job is to work with AIG students, and so at Dillard Academy we have a separate Google Classroom that's just for our AIG students, and we actually Zoomed today. We have one Zoom a week, and then they have their activities in Google Classroom as well. So we are working with our AIG students.
And I can speak to the EC part of it, because the EC department has created like special Canvas courses where they can offer services, and Google Classroom also, but all of these platforms allow you to add teachers to these courses. So those support teachers can actually be in the same classroom as the regular classroom teacher offering support to those kids.
And at the secondary level, Ms. Bell, a lot of the differentiation for AID is coming into choice boards that the teachers are creating that give the choice and And Ms. Covell, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but Ms. Covell did the same thing for our teachers as well. She created a teacher website as well.
So the teacher website looks just like the parent-student one, except at the top of each of the sections is a teacher support section. And those are guides and tutorials, who to ask for help, professional development videos that we've done are all going to be linked in. Right now it's got a lot on there, but we're still adding stuff as we go. The more stuff that I get via email or think is going to be helpful, I'm adding it, but I'm trying to do it in a way that's not going to be too overwhelming.
I appreciate the consistency in doing the icons, because I think that'll keep them from getting trapped in all those words and looking at it. It'll be overwhelming.
I wanted it to be as short and sweet as we could, because you can only do so much information without getting overwhelmed.
And you've got that, where have you got it placed at here?
It will be on the school website. We talked today about getting Karen to identify prominent places at the top of the page.
Okay. That would be great.
And then if I can just speak real shortly, we also have a professional development website that allows teachers to find where, what kind of PD that they really want to do. And it's done not through, just, it's done with three separate sections, Rockingham County Schools things, DPI's things, and things outside of DPI. And we have a section in there for content. So if they're an art teacher and are looking for good professional development, we'll have it in there where they can find it.
I do appreciate it. This is your wheelhouse. This is your wheelhouse. And these parents are having to learn this. And it's with everything that's going on in their life and with their families and everything in the background. It's overwhelming to them from what I'm hearing from individual comments. And I still have a real concern about those parents that don't have internet access and how they're going to get to it in the course of the day. But the way that's laid out, that's awesome. I
want to add to that because, matter of fact, they're starting Monday. The county has allowed the public libraries to stay open until 9 o'clock. So,
right.
Anybody who's 16 and older can come by themselves, but anybody lower than that has to bring a parent. But you know, it's just open for parents and students to be able to have access.
Just down for just then.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
And we shared those resources today with the director, so he's got that information that can easily help parents if they come and don't know how to log in. So we shared that with them today too. I won't go into these other links, but we did provide a parent orientation template for our schools so they can add in their specific information, but a lot of good information there as well. And then we added some sample elementary presentations that were part of their professional development this summer as well. I know you probably have some questions for me, so I'll get to the last slide here. A lot of our parents have been asking about, you know, the virtual learning, and they signed up and wanted to know what the next steps. Because we're starting on the 5 weeks with remote, everyone's a part of that. But we sent out a message and email to them last week telling them that if they signed up, they're guaranteed in the online virtual learning. As we transition to get closer to transitioning back to face-to-face, we'll survey those parents again and ask if they want to continue in that remote learning or if they want to come back face-to-face. We will do whatever we need to do to meet their needs. So I did want to say that. And then also, if students are not being successful, we'll work to transition them back. So that's a lot of information, and I know you probably have questions. I'll be glad to answer any that you have.
DPI has sent out some information about testing,
yes,
and maybe we can find another time to talk to us about that.
Yes.
I don't want to take up time to ask them.
I can just give you a quick update. Testing right now, there is no waiver for this current year, so we are back into a testing mode. They have given us an option of taking last year's test at the beginning of this year. We just don't feel like that's a good option. I mean, we don't need to take away more time from instruction based on something that's not going to count for anybody either. So we think that's the best move going forward, and we'll learn more as we get into the year.
I have a question. I know a lot of times at the beginning of the school year, we'll have schools that are maybe expecting to gain a teacher, or maybe the first 10 days of school, they just don't have as many students enrolled, or they have 20 more show up than they thought. What's that going to look like when we have kids who are maybe virtual for the first 5 weeks, but a school's expecting to get an additional teacher for, say third grade, for example? If there's three third grade teachers in the school, but they think they're going to get a fourth one, what's that going to look like?
Well, first of all, K-3, the class size allotment is 18 students, so that you have to make that ratio. And oftentimes what Mr. Craig will do is he will look at those numbers and make adjustments. It's very rare when you have to add a teacher more than not. The kids maybe didn't show up at a certain school and you're having to look at taking the teacher away. But what we would do is we would look at those allotments, and anything from grade 4 and up, you know, really doesn't have a class size limit. So we allotted 21 to 29 in 4th and 5th grade. I think it's 1 to 30 or 33 in middle school. I can't remember. Mr. Craig's not here. Then 1 to, I think, 36 at the high school level. So it's not a matter of just hitting, like, 28. You know, he looks at, you actually have to have 29 before he even considers that. And then he starts looking at what is your grade before or after that? Is there a potential for a combination class? So I think you're asked about when will parents know, and the honest answer to that is they won't know until, you know, until we kind of see the numbers in the class. The principals do have, by grade level, the number of requests that of parents that have signed up for online learning. So they know right now. And we had some schools that had like a 7 in first grade and maybe 6 in second grade. So our direction to the principals were, you need to look at potentially having a combo class, 1-2, for a virtual option, because you're not, you don't have enough students in there to warrant another teacher. So it's really no different than a normal year when we were looking at allotments and making adjustments. We just know that it just creates more anxiety, I guess, this year because people don't know. So I don't know if that answers your question, but it's still probably that 10 days. I know Mr. Craig is really looking at those numbers, and he starts having conversations with principals very early on if it looks like the numbers are not there. Or and principals, I can tell you, start calling him if it looks like they have, you know, potential for a need for another teacher. So, but that happens within that first, you know, 10 days, maybe first 3 weeks.
Dr. Purvis, will you be required to report attendance?
Yes.
First 10 days?
Yes. We have to record, as I mentioned, instead of seeing them face-to-face, if you talk to them, see them on Zoom, that counts as their initial enrollment. And then after that, as long as they are checking in every day, even that can include assignments, then the teacher can include that as attendance as well. The new code is present, but working also. That's the new code that we need to use.
And the ratio is 1:31.68 and 1:36.9
for 9-12. Thank
you
all very much.
Thank you. And let me say thank you to my team. This is a great team.
Y'all got to go first. You got to figure out stuff. Well, y'all got to figure out stuff. That's great. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you all.
We're going to move on to the next report, reentry plan and safety updates. Dr. Shockwell and Dr. Ellis.
All right. I'm going to let Dr. Ellis get started.
Ready. Want me to share my screen, Dr. Shotwell?
I'm getting ready to.
Oh, okay.
I know you're faster on this Zoom thing than I am.
Oh, no. I'm just making sure I got it right.
Let's see. Okay. All right. There we go. It's rolling. It's going to get there. Yeah, you can go ahead and just steal the share from me. It'll be fine.
Okay, I think you might have to enable me to, I think.
Oh, there it is. Okay.
Okay. All right, wonderful. Well, good evening, Madam Chair and Board of Education and Dr. Shotwell. Dr. Shotwell and I wanted to provide school safety updates for you all this evening. And so we appreciate your time and you have heard a great deal from our last meeting in July about many of the safety updates, but I did want to share with you a few new updates. And so we had our school safety summit last Thursday, and we trained all 22 of our schools and our district sites in our school safety summit, and they received school crisis plan updates as well as COVID-19 updates. And I think it went really well, and each crisis team along with the COVID-19 contact was trained. And so you can go back to that slide, Dr. Shotwell, that has the starburst there. This particular, you've seen, this is our Safe Return to Learn engagement book. and it really has all of the safety protocols, everything that we have around what those safety protocols are. While you have seen this, this particular link is updated, and Ms. Heiler is going to post it on the website, and it will not have to be removed because it can now go into a Google Drive where it will not distort the book because it does have a lot of graphics. And any update, we have had two particular updates since our last presentation from DHHS, and so we've had to make some changes in there around handling presumptive cases, and then also some updated information around traveling to hotspots. So when you open that, you will see a table that will tell you when we've had to make those updates as we've received new regulations. All right. And these are the four documents that we have had to really utilize to look at, you know, and to base all of our regulations on. And this is sort of what guides us in each of our decisions and what we're required to do. So the first three documents are from DHHS, the Department of Health and Human Services. And the first one has to do with the Public Health Toolkit, which has a lot of regulations in it. The second one is around the PPE guidance, which is the actual PPE equipment that the state provided to us. And it gives specific directions as to how we're supposed to use that and how that's supposed to be disseminated. And the third one is really, really important because it has all of the requirements around suspected, presumptive, or confirmed cases. And I've provided hyperlinks there for you all so you can read them more in detail. But that third one, we are especially having to keep printed off and keep with us at all times. The fourth one is the Lighting Our Way Forward, which is the DPI guidance document. And every single one of these documents have had updates since our last board presentation. So we've had to reflect that in our guidance. All right. And we can keep going there. All right, and then the other thing that we have ordered, Dr. Parks and myself and her department, we work really closely together to select some signage for Rockingham County Schools. And so we have placed that order, and right now when you go to our schools, you will see certain signage on the door that says on the right, this is from DHHS, and that's a requirement for us to post. It basically says if you have any of these symptoms, please do not come within the facility. And if you do, you know, please refrain from coming in, and here are what the symptoms are that you need to look for. So there's information there on the right for that. But then also we'll have signage all throughout the school around maintaining social distance, around wearing a cloth face covering, waiting 6 feet apart, and washing hands. And then we'll also have a washing hands poster as well. So a lot of this is about prevention, and that's one of the main ways that we want to try to slow the spread from becoming more intense in Rockingham County. And so in each of our schools and each of our building facilities, we have screening protocols that are in place. So if there has been an exposure but the person's had no symptoms, they cannot come into the building, whether this be a person or a student. If they've had a diagnosis, even and they have not had any symptoms, they cannot come in the building. And then if they have just even one symptom, they still cannot come into the building. So that is required from the Department of Health and Human Services. And so if they have none of those difficulties, then they can come to the school. And how that works is we've actually created an app for the whole school district. Barry McCorkrum has been wonderful, and I worked with him and told him what we needed in the app. Myself and Amanda Perkins, our lead school nurse, and we both worked with him and shared with him what needed to be in the app, and he has created that for us, and every single person in the school district can download that app, put it on their phone, and it asks them those main questions. Do they have any symptoms? Have they been around anybody? And so those four main questions, as long as they answer no, they can proceed forward to come to school and to come to work. If they say yes to any of them, they need to notify their supervisor immediately. And the thing that's really nice about the app is immediately when they say yes, it'll notify their supervisor if there are any concerns, so the supervisor can follow up with that particular person and make sure we have a plan for safety and prevention before they come into the school. All right. Go to the next one. And then this is sort of our flow chart, and this happens for students as well as staff. When staff then, once they complete that health screening, they're asked to do that prior to setting foot in work. And so once they complete that health screening, once they come to work, they will get their temperature taken. DHHS has not required school districts to record normal temperatures, only temperatures that are 100 degrees and above. So so what that means is we also have one other app where if anyone has been diagnosed, been exposed, or exceeds that temperature or shows a symptom, we have to have what's called an isolation room where we keep them away from everyone else until they can go home. We've also created that app as well that will kind of hold anybody who's displayed any symptoms, what we did, exactly what procedures we've taken, what steps we've taken. And so if we get to the place where our kids get to come back to school, which I know we all dearly would love to have happen, this is sort of how it will look for students. When the student arrives to school, whatever format that will be, through car or bus, and we'll talk about those specifically in just a minute, but the student will be screened for COVID-19. They will be asked those health screening questions that are listed on that DHHS poster, and then they will have their temperature taken. If they have no flags, nothing comes up, they go straight to class. And if they become symptomatic, then we have a protocol that we follow for that. You can kind of see that arrow goes back over to that yellow area. Now, if for some reason they've had an exposure, they have symptoms, or they have a diagnosis, they are taken to that isolation area, and that's where the school nurse or their designated COVID-19 contact will make sure that we reevaluate the child's temperature, we look at anything, and then we make a contact with the parent, and then they will go home at that point. So there is a link there for that reference guide that I was talking to you about, but we're gonna go over that in just a little bit more detail in just a minute, how important that document is for us. And so, and you can keep going, Dr. Schott. Well, I actually got a little ahead of myself there on that slide. So for the student screening process, prior to them even coming and following that approach, that flow chart, if they are a bus rider, because it's so unsafe, if really, to pull over on the side of the road and have individuals taking temperatures on the side of the road, DHHS has allowed us to use a bus attestation form, which means that the parents can sign to indicate that they will not send their students to school with symptoms, an exposure, or a diagnosis. So they're attesting to that fact, and then they have to wear their face covering on the bus unless that they are a medical exemption, and or they have a developmental reason, a developmental delay that will not allow them to wear the face covering. But otherwise, they would need to wear the face covering. And so then they will sit one person on the bus, and siblings can ride together side by side. And then what will happen is once they get to school, they will immediately follow that whole flow chart that I just showed you, and they will have their temperatures checked, the health screening will take place, and then they can proceed forward as long as they're not flagged there. There will also be school attestation forms for car riders, bus riders, any student who comes to school. And so if they're a car rider, what essentially happens is the same flow chart is followed, but they still have to attest that they are not sending their child to school. With a fever, with any of the symptoms, and they will submit this at that point when students are able to come back, and then we will complete that health screening as the students come in. And again, DHHS does not require us to write down and record normal temperatures, only temperatures that exceed the 100 degrees. And then when you go, and you can keep going down, and then this particular book, this is that reference guide. There's a hyperlink again on the side, but that chart right there is sort of like the very important guidebook, okay? So the purple figure that you see there, that includes anyone who comes to school upon arrival. So whether they come as a car rider, whether they come as a bus rider, however they come, they will basically arrive at school, and if they display any of those symptoms, whether it be exposure, a diagnosis, or they have any symptoms that will tell us exactly what protocols to follow. So we've asked every school to keep these printed copies, and this will stay in the isolation room, and it gives you step by step exactly what we are required to do. This is what will be entered in the isolation app, what page number we follow, which will have every single step according to whatever the exposure is for the student. The green area that you see there has to do if symptoms come up during the day or there's a possible exposure during the day and what we're required to do. So it's really scripted out, and that came just recently, sort of at the end of July. So we have updated our guidebook, and all of this was shared in our school safety summit on Thursday, so the individuals know exactly what to do. And just so you can get a quick snapshot without having to go through every one of those pages in the guidebook, if you can go to the next slide, Dr. Shotwell, this is what it is. That's what the protocols actually review. It explains that students or staff need to go to the isolation room, that there's an infection control process, transportation is discussed, how they're going to get home. Then there's a notification. And then if we need to have a school closure, most of the school closures are around if the student was not following the safety precautions. That's why it's so important that we follow the regulation that's mandated for us from DHHS, from the Department of Public Instruction, from DPI, and the State Board of Education has required all students wear face coverings, even when social distancing is possible. And this is because that would lead to more instructional time if they actually, and safety, not only just instructional time, but safety for students, and we'd be less likely to have to close the entire school. So any school closure, we would immediately talk with the health department first, and they would guide us through contact tracing, and we would have that discussion, and then you guys, of course, would be notified as a board if that was something that we had to do. And then obviously there's deep cleaning that takes place, and then communication. We do have to follow that HIPAA and FARPA, and we're not allowed to release the names of individuals who have specific diagnoses, but we can indicate if someone is in a situation where they might have been exposed, they would absolutely be notified, and the health department would work with us through that process to make sure that we followed all the appropriate steps. All right. To the next one.
I didn't hear a ding, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. And then our confirmed case was, if we do have a confirmed case, the school nurse would notify myself along with Amanda Perkins, our lead school nurse, and Amanda Perkins and I would work together with the health department to share all of the information. And like I said, we have those two apps for our whole district, the health screening app and the isolation app, that would record every action step. So if anybody asks us anything, what we did, what exactly happened, it would be there as a record and a document so that we can keep track of what those needs are and what all of those responses would be. The next slide, just in case you were wondering about that PPE equipment that came from the governor, it did arrive, and we had the touchless thermometers, which are used for the screening for students and staff, and there are one per 100 students for each school, so each school received those, and we sent those out last week. There are two surgical masks per day per school nurse, or 10 per week. Two surgical masks or 10 per day for the COVID-19 contact, which is a delegated staff that works with the nurse. And then also an additional amount based on percentage just there in case students happen to need them for whatever reason. Also, there are two face shields per school nurse and two face shields per school. And then also disposable gowns, where they will receive 5 gowns per week for elementary and 2 gowns per week for middle and high. And the reason for that they listed in the guidebook is because elementary students are more likely to have upset stomach with COVID-19. So that was the reason behind giving more gowns to the elementary age. And then also face coverings have now, some schools have already gotten them, but everybody will get them by tomorrow. Face coverings for, there will be 3 from our Reidsville Area Foundation grant that Dr. Parks submitted. And so those are really awesome. You guys got some of those, but that is, I call them rock star spirit gear, right? And there are face coverings that look like this. And so each of those face coverings will be provided to all of our staff. And then also there are two face coverings from Rockingham County Schools that are provided to students. Plus each student will get a package of 5 face coverings as well. So each student will really have 7 face coverings total that are given to them. And then there are also hand sanitizer, facial tissues, EPA cleaning solutions are provided through Mr. Stoffel and the maintenance department. Each principal and their lead custodian submit their order to Mr. Stoffel, and all of that is provided to the school when we have students here at the school. And of course they still have those supplies even when students aren't at school, but that continued supply will be made available as they need it for students when they're in the building as well. All right, so I think, and then lastly, you can go to the social distance and practices slide. We just wanted to let you see the operations team and myself and Dr. Corcoran have been working hard on trying to go to schools to really provide some examples of social distancing classrooms. So you can see this is an elementary and a high school and a middle school example. So the first one on your left is an elementary lower grades classroom. The next one is a middle school classroom. The one on the bottom left is an upper elementary classroom, and the one on the top left is a high school classroom. So you can see there's not as many desks in there, and it does essentially reduce the classroom by 50% in order to be able to follow the social distancing protocol. And so we have ordered social distancing markers, and we will be setting up mock social distancing sites and taking some more pictures and bringing you some updates on that. Schools will have access to those social distancing markers where they'll be able to put them in the bathrooms, in the hallway, in the classrooms, just to make sure that we're following that appropriate requirement from DHHS and from DPI and all of the different areas that have provided that regulation. And then lastly, this is our link to our Google site, and we'll just be providing updates there. And like I said, Ms. Heiler's gonna post that Google, our Safe Return to Learn, which has a list of the updates that we talked about tonight, so that individuals will be able to find that if they wonder, as we get updates, where that happens in the guidebook. So we just want to thank you for your support, and we were happy to, we had a successful school safety summit, and everyone is doing a great job enacting their safety plans in this area so far, and we will continue to do our very best in this new way of functioning. So thank you so much, and I'll be glad to take any questions.
Any questions, Mr. Austin? Not a question. I come across some information, and this has nothing to do with Ms. Ellis's report coming in, but I did learn that the state has shared Ms. Ellis's crisis response protocols and their best practice guides for other schools throughout the district to mirror their protocols out there. So I thought that was something else.
Sure.
I've
got Ellis.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm curious about the high school classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
Approximately how many desks were you able to socially distance in those high school classrooms?
That there was a consistent amount, it really does depend on the square footage of that particular classroom. But we were able to get, in most of them, around 16 to 18 desks. So there were some where we were able to get a few more than that, but not really over 16 to 18 desks as an average. And so in talking with our high school principals when we did this, so far they were looking at their class rosters, and if we were on a plan B, if they went back and we were at the 50% capacity, most of them were able to make that work with the classes that they were there. They may have to move some locations around for some of their bigger classrooms, but that is something that they are looking at as they're working on setting those up.
The delegate staff that you were talking about that was going to, I guess, help out the school nurse, is that someone who's going to be on staff all the time?
Yes, it would be someone that's on their staff. And what we've done is we've allowed each school principal along with their crisis team to to identify that individual, and they were to submit their name this week to me. And so that we asked them to try to think of that ahead of time and bring them to the safety summit as well. But if that wasn't possible, we will also have the school nurses provide additional training for them. And the purpose for them is to really just to be there to make sure that we follow the protocols. Because when you look at that reference guide, it has a specific outline of exactly what we're supposed to do and even check boxes where they can check just to make sure that we don't miss any of that protocol if a person comes up with a symptom or a diagnosis or an exposure. And so that's really the purpose of that COVID-19 contact.
And then one other question I had, I guess it's really important for our students when we do get to come back to school, because we are going to get to come back to school on it.
Yeah,
sure. It's really important for them to know the importance of wearing those masks. Because what I'm hearing you say is that if someone gets symptoms during the day, and as long as they have had their mask on and followed those protocols, then we won't have to shut that classroom down and shut that school down and that sort of thing, right?
That is most likely. Now, each case, you know, we have to go over it with the health department, and it could lend itself to something. And we are having to do that each individual case. However, I can say this summer, there have been over 65 individuals I've consulted with, all right, through COVID-19, just exposures this summer, all right? In addition, we've had about 10 times we've had to kind of close. And so each of the cases that they were wearing face coverings or those safety precautions are occurring, we did not have to close. So the most often we wear those face coverings, that would mean that we would get to most likely stay open. Now, we did do some of those closures out of really safe precaution, just because we could, you know, if we can't guarantee something 100% or we feel like there's any sort of risk at all, we always want to err on the side of caution. So some of those were erring on the side of caution. But I can tell you from the health department, they have said us wearing our cloth face coverings and, you know, following those safety precautions and washing our hands, that is so, so critical to us being able to remain open.
Ms. Ellis, Dr. Ellis. So are we talking to our students, and is information going home to parents about how to clean their face masks? Because there's also reports out there where people are getting sick when wearing face masks so often or for so long.
Yes, and that's actually part of our safety protocols too. The nurses have a meeting tomorrow, and they are also going to be sharing information that in order to, you know, for everyone to make sure that they're doing exactly what you're saying, making sure those face coverings are cleaned. We'll have information that we can do alert nows about, that we can post. And then also what will happen is that our nurses, along with our school psychologists, are completing a lesson around how do I keep myself safe. And we really wanted to bring that social emotional piece into it as well. But we wanted our school nurses to make sure that they were there to be able to say, you know, here's exactly how you should put your face covering on, here's how you should wear it, here's a video that shows how to do it, here's a video that shows how to clean it. And so they are actually finishing that this week, and that they will be able to, everyone will be able to show those during their SEL, social emotional time. And so those lessons have already been shared out. And each of the behavioral health problem solving teams that include our school nurse, they will be making sure that those are distributed to each and every one of our students through virtual learning. So they'll be able to have that lesson around, how do I keep myself safe? How do I keep others safe? How do I make sure that my cloth face coverings are clean? And what do I need to do? And why is it so important, you know, that I wear this cloth face covering? What does this really mean? Because it's not easy for any of us to wear it. You know, it's really not. And so we recognize that, and we know it's going to be a challenge for all of us to do that. And so we want to be able to provide those supports in that way.
Any other questions? Thank you very much, Dr. Ellis. Appreciate that.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Very thorough, as always. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Corcoran and Dr. Williamson, they're going to do MTSS and PBIS implementation plan. And we're going to try to get through this one, and then we will table the last two items so that we can move into closed session. So we'll table them to the August the 24th board meeting.
Thank you. And Dr. Shotwell, you'll just move those slides along for us as we move along in our presentation. So thank you very much. Madam Chair, Dr. Shotwell, Board of Education members, tonight Dr. Williamson and I are here to talk to you about MTSS, Multi-Tiered Systems of Support, and PBIS, Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports. And I am presenting, and so is Dr. Williamson, based on a request by the board to just have more information and to be provided with some updates. So I'm going to go through the first couple of slides, and then I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Williamson, who is our MTSS coordinator for our school district and doing a great job. And so I'll just say this about MTSS. It is, as I said, multi-tiered systems of support program. It is a framework of school improvement. Goals of MTSS are to just strengthen those instructional practices by providing very engaging and effective learning opportunities. It is, as you can see from our diagram there in front of you on the presentation, it is about looking at both aspects of the student, not only the behavioral, but also the academic. So we're really looking at not only just when we think about behavior, we think also like, why is that student perhaps not coming to school? What is the student's social and emotional behavioral? What does it look like for that student? What are their mental health needs? And so looking at that from a problem-solving team effort. And as you can see, when you look at the green, the yellow, and the red, we're looking at these tiers of support from core, which is at the bottom there, you see in our green tier, to supplemental, and then to intensive. And we'll see in our red there is our very intensive kinds of tier support. And so also with MTSS, it is aligned with the NC STAR and very much a part of the conversation about strategic leadership and our plan. So our school leadership teams, they have these structures in place, and Dr. Williamson has done a fabulous job, honestly, of going out and making sure that our schools feel very comfortable about those teaming structures. She meets with them at the end of every year and works with them in terms of a couple of different items that I know she's going to talk about. So again, when you look at our core instruction, you see our tier one school-wide. And again, if you see that right there, you'll see the green. That is core instruction. And we believe that all students are part of the school population. That includes our EC students. So core instruction is extremely important for all of our students. And then we think about, as you see there too, you'll just see that that is our tier one. And then when you think about CASA, which is where we look at our students in data, and this is our problem solving in which our schools meet together and they talk about CASA and they talk about data in CASA. They talk about data and they talk about meeting the needs of students and they problem solve around that. Students can move from tier one to tier two, which would be that supplemental support. Now, the supplemental support is on top of core instruction, so I really want to make sure you understand we're not taking them away from the core instruction in terms of not, you know, making that any less or any less important, but we are giving them additional support. And then tier three is where we really start to look at that student that is truly struggling. They've had those supplemental supports, and now they're still struggling, and now we're looking at some more intensive kinds of support. And so just very quickly before Dr. Shotwell, just if you'll go back to my slide just for a minute, just at the bottom here, I just want to also say too that this is an opportunity for our schools to really be proactive and to provide support and interventions to meet the needs of students and their specific needs. And then we progress monitor. We use data points and look at that student. So teachers provide instruction, and that that looks different from different levels, and then we offer that as a way to support and provide data. And then in CASA meetings, those teachers look at those progress monitoring notes and data points, and then examine that student's growth and determine whether or not that student is going to move to the next tier. So I will turn it over to Ms. Williamson. That was a fast and furious part of that presentation, but I'll let Dr. Williamson go now.
Thank you, Dr. Corcoran. Good evening, Madam Chair, Board Members, and Dr. Shotwell. I'm going to start with this next slide. As Dr. Corcoran mentioned, MTSS is designed to address the needs of students across areas of concern, including academics, attendance, social emotional health, mental health, and behavior. And most of you are familiar with PBIS, as Rockingham County Schools has been implementing positive behavioral interventions and supports for over a decade now. PBIS is the behavioral component of MTSS, so it falls under the MTSS umbrella. As you will see on this slide, PBIS is important in our schools for many reasons, such as promoting school safety, creating a positive and engaging learning and work environment for students and staff. PBIS is also an integral part of increasing academic achievement, attendance, and graduation rates. PBIS teams work together to create behavioral expectations and procedures for students to reduce the number of inappropriate behaviors and increase instructional time. PBIS also creates clear procedures for how to consistently handle disciplinary incidents. PBIS teams examine behavioral data over time so that they can look for patterns and problem solve around the needs of students and implement appropriate action steps and interventions. Some of these interventions may include things such as our check-in, check-out program that you've probably heard about, assigning mentors to students, or connecting students to mental health or social emotional resources. Dr. Shockwell, can you go to the next slide, please? All public schools in North Carolina are expected to fully implement MTSS in the 2021 school year. In fact, effective July 1st, 2020, the state's new SLD policy requires that progress monitoring data obtained through MTSS interventions be used to determine eligibility and special education services for students with specific learning disabilities. As such, our school MTSS teams are working with district leadership to ensure that we have research-based intervention options readily in place to support our students. These programs include things such as Achieve 3000 and iReady Reading and Math, along with intervention options for behavior and mental health and social emotional needs that you've heard Dr. Ellis speak about recently. We want to ensure that kids have access to instruction and programs to best meet their needs. And we want to also make sure that we have ways to examine their growth over time using effective assessments and progress monitoring tools. And all of those things, those assessments and progress monitoring tools, are used to guide our instructional practices and make adjustments to instruction as needed. So as you know, we've been implementing MTSS and PBIS for many years now in our district. This actually makes our sixth year. We're going into our sixth year of MTSS. And all 22 of our schools are actively implementing at this time. Our high schools were the last cohort to come on board in the 2019-20 school year when they began their CCRG courses, or their career and college readiness courses, to meet state graduation requirements and MTSS requirements. And each of our schools participate yearly in an MTSS review process in which they examine their growth with MTSS implementation. We usually do this in the spring of every year. This year it was a little different because we did it in online Zoom meetings, but it was still very productive. Each school has a team of MTSS members that meet with me, and we conduct a self-assessment. It's called the FAM-S, which is the lights just went out.
They did. Somebody outside probably closed. I'm sorry, Holly, somebody did it outside.
Sorry, guys. It's time to go home. The lights went out first, Holly. That's so funny. The lights upstairs are sensor operated. So if nobody's walking up and down the hall, the lights go out. What was I saying? I got scared in the dark. So anyway, we do this MTSS self-assessment at the end of each school year, and I sit down with the MTSS team at each school. We do that self-assessment, and we use that to create some action steps and goals that integrate into their school improvement plan for the following year. Okay, next slide, number six. So this is a graph, and as you can see here, we are very proud of the progress that each of our schools have made with MTSS implementation. This shows you that district-wide, our schools are in the top third or the top quartile for implementation in every area. And I know this graph is kind of small, I can't even see it all right now, but it's looking at how is the school doing in terms of implementation for leadership and building the structures and capacity, and looking at data for problem solving, those types of things. And our schools are doing very well. Go to the next slide. At our last school board meeting, we discussed considerations for MTSS implementation during COVID-19. And I've included that slide here once again, and a link to the full MTSS implementation document that you can view. As I mentioned previously, it's more important than ever for our schools to rely on the MTSS framework for supporting students during this crisis, especially since we're trying to acquire the resources that are needed, making sure that we're developing master schedules to accommodate the needs of students and staff, and also for providing those professional development and training opportunities for educators. It's our MTSS teams at each school that are responsible for working with staff and families to identify student needs and determine the best way to support each child. Before we go tonight, I just wanted to share with you a few things that are on the horizon. NCDPI is working on an online portal that will help us manage all of the data utilized for making educational decisions for children, and it's called the MTSS ECATS app. You may have heard Dr. Watkins speak about ECATS before, as the EC department began using it last year. This is the MTSS portion of that app, and it's going to pull information from PowerSchool and iReady and any other vendors that we gather data from, and it will help to gather that assessment and diagnostic data and upload it in a way that makes it easy for our teachers to identify students at risk. It'll also allow teachers to group students into interventions based off of similar instructional needs, and will organize progress monitor data in a way that makes it easy for them to read and understand. A group of us at the district level attended training in July, and we've been told that this MTSS app will be available for use in late fall. So moving forward, we will continue to acquire resources and intervention options and progress monitoring tools for our schools, including pre-K. And we will be offering another training session in late September in which we will update schools on the resources that are available and make connections to the new SLE policy. There will be ongoing trainings around mental health and social emotional wellness, which are essential parts of MTSS. And then finally, we're going to dedicate this year to making sure that we are implementing MTSS with fidelity, making sure that all the work that we're doing is carried out as we outlined it in our MTSS implementation plans and school improvement plans. So that was a very brief overview, and I am out of breath from running down the hall. So I'm going to pause until I speak this time and take any questions you may have.
Dr. Williamson.
Yes, ma'am.
I know that MTSS is an integral part of school improvement plans. And I guess that question should be for Dr. Shotwell. Will schools, are we just going to forget about school improvement plans this year?
No, they're all still working on those. It's the NC STAR program that we're using. We're also tying in the strategic plan. And we're still going to have school improvement plans and everything. They still have targeted goals they need to meet.
Can I add something to that?
Absolutely.
So the state did give districts and schools an extension on last year's school improvement plan. So we are continuing with the last year's version of the plan through December of this year. So they have given us an extension. Just to get back into the swing of regular school, whenever that happens. So we will do updated goals beginning probably in late October, November, and getting ready for that December date.
One last question. I know that the social-emotional learning piece is very popular, I guess, on a national level. Have we done a lot with that, or are we planning to do a lot with training in that area?
So I've done a lot of training, but I'll let Dr. Ellis, I know she does a lot of our training for us, and certainly we'll turn it over to her and let her tell you what we've done with that.
Sure. So, yes, ma'am, we have. Last year we had 6 pilot schools that implemented social-emotional screening, and also began their implementation with social-emotional learning. And so then also that was sort of our connection with the behavioral health problem-solving teams. That group makes up our instructional support team, which includes our school counselors, our school psychologists, social workers, and behavioral health specialists. And so they are all working to connect students with those social emotional supports and helping our teachers make those connections as well and integrate into their everyday lessons. But this year I'm really excited because all of our schools through our reentry planning process, we had lots of principals weigh in and expressed a lot of concern around social emotional needs, as well as our teachers and as well as our parents through a lot of those groups. So we are going to be able to complete social emotional screening for all of our students to be able to connect them quicker and faster with those interventions that they might need if they do have a reason to be at risk or anything like that. But then also, we are able to, through our grants, through the Project Aware grant and also the UNCG grant that I've talked with you guys about in the past, those grants are allowing us to purchase social emotional curriculum for our schools, and they'll be able to teach those social emotional skills like responsible decision making, self-awareness, social awareness, all of those things that you really need, all of those skills that are just so important to being a successful leader, you know, as you work through school, but then also as you begin to seek out into the world, whether it be an employment or whether it be going to college or whatever your endeavors might be, those social emotional skills are so critical. So so we will be scaling that up even more this year, and we'll be, of course, providing you guys updates as well about that throughout the year also with our implementation. But I will say we made a lot of progress last year with those initial those grants that we received. We made huge progress with being able to develop those behavioral health problem solving teams in each of our schools. All 22 of our schools implemented that process and have made tons of support for our students. And we had over 11,000 social, emotional, and mental health contacts with our students just last year in the 2019-2020 school year. So I know that'll be even better as we go into the 2021 school year as we scale that up even more.
And I'd like to add to what Dr. Ellis said, and that is that and just to answer your question, Ms. Bell, too, it really is a framework for total school improvement. So not just those academic pieces, but also that social, emotional, behavioral, really looking at the whole child. And that's really what we are looking at when we look at MTSS, is we're really problem solving around the whole child.
Thank you.
And Dr. Corcoran, I'd like to add to that, just in listening to this presentation, and I know several of the board has already heard this several times and have asked lots of questions, and you guys have been gracious to answer those questions. But I see MTSS as addressing that equity issue for our students and making sure that they have the resources that they need and looking at the whole child, like you said, and making sure that they have what they need, when they need, and how they need it. So I appreciate that piece of that. Of this model and how it works, and I'm excited that it is a way that we can address all of our students' needs.
Well, thank you, and again, I'd just like to echo the praise and say the praise again for my team and what our team does as a department, and just really blessed to have these ladies working so hard, both Dr. Williamson and Dr. Ellis and Dr. Watkin is because all of this is also tied very closely with how we identify students with disabilities. And, you know, now, as Dr. Williamson said, this is the year that we must implement. Mm-hmm. And so this is not something that we have a choice about. This is something that DPI has said that we will do, and we are poised and ready.
Any other questions, comments? I just want to thank them for all the work they put into this. I know that they work really hard.
Thank you so much.
All right, we're going to take, did you have something else, Dr. Williamson?
I just said thank you very much.
Okay. All right, we're going to thank you. We're going to have about a 10-minute break, and then, Mr. Isley, do you have a motion to go into closed session?
Yeah, you want to go ahead and do that now?
Yeah, let's go ahead and do that, and then we'll just break into break for 10 minutes.
Okay, Madam Chair, I move that we go into closed session to discuss personnel issues under General Statute 143-318-11A6 and adopt that language.
Do we have a second?
A second.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so we'll take a 10-minute break. We will come back together at 8:15.
Right.